So, good morning, dear friends. Welcome once again to this class. Today, I want to do two things. One, I want to give you an overall view of what we have been doing. And for that, I will just go through the notes that are given to you. I am taking only the shorter version of the notes. Just have a look at these notes. This is your notes on philosophical anthropology. Philosophical anthropology main for online course module that is actually slightly adapted for this year for you. I have also uploaded the larger version, which I would like you to read for reference. This is the same course that most of us together prepared for IGNU Master of Philosophy. Okay. Let's start with the week one and go up to week six. In the first week, I am actually using the headline. Therefore, on the left side, you see the headline. For those of you who are not very familiar, go to view mode and click on this navigation pane. And if I unclick that, of course, the notes will come as it is. But it is much better for us to view, but this is possible only in a laptop or desktop. So the first week, introduction to philosophical anthropology, other names for it, the Indian situation, shortage of justice we have, not shortage of food. Our approach is phenomenological and hermeneutical. And then the statement, philosophy or better theology is anthropology. Every talk about God is talking about ourselves. Then we see the contents of the book. That is week number one. Dear friends, I want you to go through the whole notes, and this makes it easy for you to read and understand. Week number two, the human person, a phenomenological introduction. Those who can ask the right questions, they can set us thinking, they can really challenge us. We have an oppressive and liberative understanding of the human person. Black Lives Matter and the death of George Floyd, these were significant events in America. Something similar is happening also to our Indian situation, the oppressive caste system we have to get rid of. Although legally, caste system is abolished, it is very much in our blood, including in among us Christians. Being human today, and especially the poor and the hungry, and in this context, let us also remember the migrants, many of them sacrificed their lives. Let us also remember the smaller people who are forgotten. And as leaders, we are supposed to represent, plead for them in front of God and also in front of the powerful authorities. Third week, what is human nature? The nature of being human. Plato and Augustine, they had a dualistic, dichotomized understanding of body and soul. A dichotomized understanding of the human person. Body is opposed to the spirit. Body is bad. Therefore, the worldly things are bad, including sex. Unfortunately, many of our own people also tend to believe in that theory that body is bad. We need to bring them out of that. The earth is precious, vulnerable. It can also create bad things, violence, bloodshed. But the earth itself is not bad because God has created the whole universe and found it good. That is Plato's dualistic understanding. The imagery of the cave, I want you to remember. Then we have Aristotle and company. They have actually a more integrated understanding, a more integrated understanding of the body and the soul. Then some recent Christian thinkers like Theravada, Karl Rahner, and so on. The two books of Karl Rahner, very, very important they are. Hearers of the Word and Spirit in the World. Then Theravada would speak about human beings being evolution that has become conscious of itself. Evolution that has become conscious of itself. Then we have Viktor Frankl and the search for meaning. The greatest freedom that we have is to change our attitude and give meaning to whatever we do, the suffering included. For example, in this COVID time, we do question ourselves, we do question God, why so many people? About 6 lakh people are dead. Why this, why that? But in spite of our questioning, can we give meaning to ourselves, meaning to this pandemic? And can we be messengers of peace, messengers of joy? The existentialist philosophy, existentialism, you know, is by Kierkegaard, Heidegger, Jasper, and so on. The dread, the angst, the anxiety, the emptiness that we feel today. These are all existentialist concerns. The dread, the fear, the anxiety, and so on. Okay, that is about the human nature. There is something of that sinfulness in human nature, the selfishness. But human beings are not totally selfish. There is so much of love, tenderness, and goodness in the human person. Now we come to the origin and development of human person. You see, the text is here. There is this inner conflict. We are symbol-using animals. Without something tangible, we really cannot experience ourselves. We need symbols. God Himself can be approached by us through symbols. In this sense, Jesus is the real symbol of God for each one of us. Then the phenomenon of development, how we develop ourselves, grow. In three things, we are totally one with the rest of the world: the mineral kingdom, the vegetative kingdom, and the animal kingdom. But beautiful, three things we are unique: our conceptual language, creative art, and transcendental religion. This transcendence, this uniqueness, we can speak of world openness to the world, wealth of and height, or in simple terms, this uniqueness is what gives us the culture. We are cultural beings. We are not merely social, but we are social and cultural beings. And as cultural beings, we can pass on the culture to our own posterity. That is the uniqueness, which I am not sure whether animals can do it. Okay? The fourth unit, introducing human freedom. Initially, we must acknowledge that we are totally one with the rest of the universe. And for that, the speech of the chief of Seattle, 1786 to 1866, that's very, very, very significant. Please read this speech at least thrice. Make sense of it. I'm sure our tribal brothers would feel very much at home. This is the tribal way of life among the Red Indians, among the Africans, among the Australians, and definitely among the Indians. How can you buy or sell the sky, the warmth of the land? Okay, now comes the phenomenon of freedom, a definition of freedom. Freedom is being in possession of my own self, mastery of one's own act. That is how we understand freedom. Remember, the word definition is not all that correct. When it comes to freedom, when it comes to human beings, all that we can aspire is understanding, better understanding, approaching. Definition is there for physics, for chemistry, for science. Then we can approach that human freedom through intellect and will. The volitional dynamism. Yesterday we spoke about the intellectual dynamism, that was transcendental analysis. We can also speak about the volitional dynamism. Our will longs for the good, and ultimately our will be satisfied only when we are in possession of the ultimate good. This ultimate goodness is what we call God. Ultimately, as Augustine says, our hearts are restless, O Lord, until it finds its rest in you. Ultimately, our search for goodness, for love, can only be fulfilled when we are totally open to Christ, to God. Okay, there are some people like Freud and Skinner who criticize freedom. They say we are determined by our psychological or sociological environments. We say we are not determined, but we are conditioned. Know the difference between being conditioned and being determined. We say we are determined when we cannot find a way out, when there is no escape route. We are so totally immersed that there is no freedom we can talk about. That is being conditioned. Sorry, being determined. But we, against Freud and Skinner, would say we are not determined. We are conditioned. Conditioned means the outside world shapes me. It challenges me. It limits me. But if I really want, I can still go beyond and find my freedom. It will be a limited freedom, but still I can find my freedom. Okay, the next unit is on human need for self-actualization. Many of the psychologists begin with the assumption that there is something fundamentally wrong with human beings. That you are a neurotic person. You need counseling, you need healing. That is the basic principle of many of the psychologists. Freud is very, very clear about it. But Abraham Maslow, a Jewish American psychologist, he speaks about positive psychology. He says there may be neurosis in each one of us, but there is also so much of goodness in each one of us. Therefore, he speaks about the hierarchy of needs. Please be familiar with this hierarchy of needs. Physiological needs, safety needs, love, esteem needs, cognitive knowledge, philosophy needs, aesthetic needs, art, symmetry, and then finally, the self-actualization needs. When I really become what I am capable of becoming, the ideal me. That is the final, the hierarchy of needs. Then Maslow's basic principles, I want you to read that, because read it and apply it to your own life. You people are young. You have so much of energy. Grow. Grow in your psychological journey of life. And together with the psychological journey, grow also in your spiritual journey. And for that, these principles of Maslow, they are extremely useful. Finally, we speak about the self-actualization. So, where there is no pathology, where people become free, liberated, that is self-actualization. Behaviors leading to self-actualization, experiencing life like a child, fully absorbed and fully concentrated, trying new things instead of sticking to the safe old routine, listening to your own feelings in evaluating experiences instead of the tradition or authority of the majority. Avoid pretending, faking. Be honest. Be prepared to be unpopular if your views do not coincide with that of the others. Don't yield to them. Take responsibility and work hard. Try to identify your defenses, your neurosis, your illusions, and have the courage to give them up. Then the characteristics of self-actualized people. Okay, these are all things: sense of humor, problem-centered, not person-centered, not self-centered, have peak experiences. In our religious terms, these peak experiences are something like, say, mystical experiences, experience of being one with nature, with God. Democratic attitude, strong ethical standards, creativity, these are all the characteristics of self-actualized persons. Then we talk about love as self-actualization. Here we are using two categories: appropriation, appropriativeness, or abandonment. I will be elaborating on these two, three things, these two things: enchantment, self-actualization. This I will be elaborating in my next presentation after 20 minutes. Then we come to the last chapter, death and life after death, or life after life. Why do we die? Is it the law of nature? Is it not something very, very natural? Why do we die? The funeral customs always speak about something special about human beings, how we venerate our dear and near ones. Then, life after death, you can have the nihilistic understanding of life after death, those who do not believe in life after death. One school would say, eat, drink, and make merry, because there is nothing after life. Then you have the socially committed, those who are concerned for the welfare of the whole. And this song, The Man from La Mancha, I want you to read. And the world will be better for this, that one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. Dear friends, if you can really reach that unreachable star, you would be doing a great favor, not only to yourself, but for the rest of humanity. So, these are the three nihilistic responses. The positive response, reincarnation, you know it, therefore we are omitting it for the time being. Please note that reincarnation is prevalent also among the tribals of Australia, also among the Greeks, especially by Plato. Then we spoke about the resurrection, the immortality of the soul. And here, the soul is immortal. The soul is not eternal, but the soul is immortal. This is the extrinsic dependency, which is proposed by Aquinas. the immortality of the soul. So this means the Christian understanding is the soul had a beginning. The soul began when we were conceived, with the beginning of our body. The soul had a beginning, like the plants and the animals. But human soul had a beginning, but it will go on even after our death. That is actually the immortality of the soul based on an extrinsic dependency. Then the resurrection of the body. We spoke about the resurrection of the body, the power of resurrection. Resurrection is not resuscitation. And it is not a question of blind faith. Something objective happened to them, and therefore it is not a question of blind faith for the disciples. Finally, resurrection of the body means, this is very important, resurrection of the body means my whole life on this earth will find its fulfillment in a new creation. This implies my relationship with others, my failures, my history, my dreams and aspirations, all these things will somehow be transformed, and all these things will be part of my risen life. Now, we don't say that only the physical body is risen. No, it is my whole body, which includes my mind, my brain, my heart, my feelings, and my soul. All these things would somehow be resurrected. That much for the time being. Let me stop the sharing. Do you have any questions, please?